Yet, others argue that artificial intelligence will create many jobs for humans as it eliminates. I've said that earlier on. Jobs will be eliminated, but there will be creation of new forms of jobs. Jobs that, the kind of jobs that we do not know currently, those jobs will be created, while some that we have now will go out of extinction. All the same, there is unease among some people. In a recent survey conducted by researchers at London's Art International Business School, only 31% feel hopeful about the prospect of living and working with artificial intelligence. Only 31% feel hopeful. And okay, while 80% feel mainly fear, there are palpable fears. Only 20% feel confident and very prepared for what is to come. It is this kind of anxiety that led to the Times Higher Education Microsoft survey. In that survey, they were asking certain research questions. What do those best positioned to give an informed view believe the consequences of the 4IR, that is the fourth industrial revolution, would be for higher education? That is, the university administrators, polytechnic administrators, what are their views about the consequences of the fourth industrial revolution? And how are higher education institutions readying themselves to respond to those changes? Their second research question was, if AI significantly reduces the demand for human labor, will it also diminish the demand for a university education? Or perhaps increase it? As desperate job seekers bolster their CVs with ever more qualifications? That was the second research question. Will the university still remain relevant in this fourth industrial revolution? Or higher education institutions generally? And even if it does, will that translate into more jobs for academics? Or will teaching and even research largely be taken over by intelligent machines too? Those are the questions that informed the survey. And these were their findings. Okay? These were their findings. Only a minority of universities currently have an AI strategy, but most plan to develop one. And I think, you know, I'm speaking to a community of intellectuals here. So we really need to start thinking, you know, of an AI strategy so that, you know, we are not left behind. Another finding in the survey was that universities find it difficult to recruit and retain staff able to teach and research artificial intelligence because the industries are paying better. Obviously, you are not likely to find people with such skills to remain in the academia or to be in the academia. The industries are snatching them away. Even here, I believe in computer science department, you'll be struggling, you know, to find lecturers in computer science department because the industries, you know, need them more and they pay them more. So the same thing, you know, is happening with artificial intelligence, which is an extension of digitization. Artificial intelligence will increase employers' demand for university graduates, or let me say higher educational institutions graduates, and will not lead to university closures. There will be need for people with high skills. And that is where, you know, the universities and polytechnics, you know, stand a good chance. And that chance can only be taken if we are ready to rethink our curricula and make our graduates relevant to the industry that is emerging. Artificial intelligence will be able to assess students. That is right. You know, human beings, you know, may not need to map again with artificial intelligence. Machines can do that. Not only multiple choice questions, Even SE. All you need to do, you know, is to provide a template. And the machine will do it for you. So machine can also provide feedback and generate and test scientific hypotheses, at least as well as humans can. Machines can do that. Machines can do that. In my institutions in South Africa, we use a lot of technology to do assessment, to do teaching. And with time, some of these things, you know, will just be done by machines. But universities will not cut teaching. Research or administration staff, and may even recruit more. And that is if we are ready to retool ourselves, to rethink our curricula. Machines can do a lot of work in science laboratories, in mixing chemicals. In chemistry lab, machines can do that. So all we need to do now is to start rethinking how we do our things. So what is the place of Africa in this revolution? What is the place of Africa in this revolution? The fact is, digital inequalities exist between the global north and south. There is no doubt about that. Digital inequalities are being blurred. The gaps are being blurred in the advanced world, you know, along gender line, along racial line, particularly, you know, in a nation like the United States. Before now, the gap between the white and the black in the US in terms of digital access and use was wide. But it is shrinking now. Before now, the gap between man and woman, between male and female, you know, in terms of gender, in terms of digital use and the access was wide, but it is shrinking now. However, the gap between nations is widening. Between the global south, as global north and the global south, the gap, you know, continues to, you know, to get wider and wider. And that is the whole purpose of digital inequalities. It is the disparities in the structure of access to and use of ICT. Digital inequalities exist in three dimensions. Inequalities in access to digital technologies. We do not have access to digital technologies the way people, you know, in the US, in Canada, in Europe, you know, the way they have it. We don't have it like that in Africa. So that is a dimension of digital inequality. Two, there is inequality in digital skills and technology use. Even when we have this access to digital technology, we are not able to use it the way we use it. So there's inequality also in the scale and in how we use the technology. I thank God, you know, that we are making some effort around here. In this conference, you know, I've seen a lot of things that have been done on social media. And right there, you know, while I was sitting, I picked some information on Facebook that this conference is being live streamed on YouTube. So to me, that is a commendable effort. So apart from the inequality in access and the use of technology, there's also inequality in outcomes, the benefit that these technologies bring to us. They use the technology and they benefit a lot from it in the advanced world, but because, you know, we do not really even have much of the scale, we are not really benefiting much from it. So these emerging technologies will bring new inequalities in access and come with issues of functionality, content availability, and openness. What is the place of Africa in this revolution? Continue. However, some efforts are already being made and certain benefits already being derived in Africa. Africa is not just folding up its arms, you know, Africa is also trying to march, you know, in this world of fourth industrial revolution. In South Africa, on April 9th this year, the president of the country, Cyril Ramaphosa, launched a commission, a presidential commission, 30% presidential commission, on artificial intelligence, on fourth industrial revolution and artificial intelligence. And interestingly, he is going to be the chairman of that commission. That tells you, you know, the seriousness that the nation of South Africa is attaching to the issue of fourth industrial revolution. So the role of this commission is to assist the government in taking advantage of the opportunities presented by the digital industrial revolution. The University of Johannesburg has spoken about this, has also established the Institute for Future of Knowledge. And the University of Pretoria is also making some effort in that wise. There's also an organization, Forum for Artificial Intelligence in Africa, which was established in December 2018 in Morocco. So these are some of the efforts being made in Africa to benefit from a to benefit from this fourth industrial revolution. Robotics, artificial intelligence, and other technologies of fourth industrial revolution could provide a welcome boost to government service, delivery. Yeah, because when you deploy artificial intelligence, a lot of queues that you find in government offices, they will diminish or they will disappear, because the machines will be there to do all this routinous work that civil servants take, you know, a lot of time to do. They will do it. Okay. Even in the issue of tender, you can use algorithm, you use artificial intelligence, you know, to work on the issue of tender. And that will remove bias. You know, it will not be a matter of, oh, because I know this contractor who brought this tender, this is the person I'm going to give. No, the machine, you know, will do the selection. And that, you know, will be good for our public service delivery. And even in recruitment, you know, you can use machine, you know, to select the candidate you want to interview. And that is one thing that, you know, we need to change, you know, here, you know, even in Nigeria. People want to want to apply for jobs. You say they should go and submit hard copies of CV. No, nobody does that again, you know, anywhere in the world. And our universities and colleges, they are even, you know, the guiltiest of this. They say, you know, submit 25 copies of your CVs, 25 copies of the applications. Let's not do it again. All over the world, applications are done online. And the selection of candidates for interview, you know, will be done by the machine. That will remove bias, you know, from the process. Okay. So, automation and artificial intelligence, which can perform routine, repetitive, or just plain dull tasks far faster and more efficiently than humans can, could also be put to good use in a host of other areas of public service, particularly those involving masses of paperwork and long queues of citizens waiting for service. Machines can do all this, and the service will be more efficient. But then there's a danger in this, as I've said. So there's now a conflict between providing jobs for the citizens and wanting to ensure efficiency of service. That's where the conflict, you know, will come about. And I guess as we go into this fourth industrial revolution, government, you know, we have to strike a balance, you know, between that. This man, Ray Kurzweil, said this, said we have the opportunity in the decades ahead to make major strides in addressing the grand challenges of humanity. AI will be the pivotal technology in achieving this progress. We have a moral imperative to realize this promise while controlling the peril. It won't be the first time we have succeeded in doing this. Of course, there are fears, there are issues of concern about AI, But AI, you know, will bring a lot of solutions to human challenges. AI, you know, is already being used in healthcare in Africa. Drones are being used to deliver medicine. Apps, you know, have been developed to diagnose diseases and to even prescribe drugs. And this is very important in Africa, particularly, you know, where we have, you know, a shortage of doctors. And more particularly in the rural areas where they do not have easy access to health clinics. And also in agriculture, AI is already being used. AI is already being deployed, you know, for harvesting, okay? And for a whole lot of other things. Certain nations in Africa are already, you know, leading in this regard. Nigeria, Kenya, South Africa, Rwanda, you know, and even Ghana. But a lot of other nations are still sleeping about this.